You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Folks, a lot of things are happening. I want you to listen very carefully tonight because I have a lot of information I need to impart to you. And if we have enough time, we'll open the phones. So make sure that you're ready to take notes. And our efforts over the past few days have been fruitful. Don't go away. Pennsylvania, the latest. The sun shone brightly on the Capitol steps, showing the weathering on the stately structure. Dingy with grime and age, the building still projects a sense of austere majesty from a bygone era. The usual traffic snarled in bunches around State Street, indicating not very much unusual. On either end of the building, two Capitol police cars sat. An additional state police cruiser lazily prowled around the main rotunda building. The driver, alert, as if a tiger circling a meadow in search of prey. Foot patrols consisted of a few additional officers. Walkie-talkies at the ready, squawking an occasional message, probably an all-clear signal to some not-too-distant command center with a reserve force not in public view. Strollers, taking advantage of the 45-degree sunshine, sauntered back and forth between an array of assorted government buildings, no one in any apparent hurry. Upon questioning a few, none at all had any idea of a planned demonstration this day. In fact, none at all had any knowledge of any deliberations regarding the Conference of States and the accompanying controversy. An inquiry into Representative Ivan Itkin's office indicated that his staff knew nothing about the Conference of States, nothing about the participation resolution, nothing about Governor Leavitt's visit to Governor Ridge, or anything at all. Yet Mr. Itkin sits on the House Rules Committee, which is in review of this entire matter. So what sort of representative is this who denies that it's even taking place? What kind of government is this where secrets slither through the corridors like an unseen poison mist? What treachery abounds? Why lie about it? You see, almost everyone we called admitted. A couple lied. What fate awaits America in Pennsylvania? Every now and then, as the noon hour approached, a few persons gathered at the Capitol steps as if searching for someone. Maybe they didn't know that we'd called off the demonstration and asked people to go to the offices of the representatives. They looked around, sort of puzzled. Some were just casual onlookers, and some were patriots, concerned Pennsylvanians who heard the call in the hour of the time radio broadcast. They went in the State House to drop off letters, notices, and other evidence of dissatisfaction with their government covertly planning such a momentous event without any grassroots awareness, the establishment press absolutely, completely silent. Brian and Joseph, both Pennsylvanians from nearby York, came, a farmer from Lancaster who had long protested what he described as government land grabs, came. Their legislatures were not there, but the staffs received the citizens' concerns. Robert, Alan, Marie, and Cynthia came from as far as Long Island, New York. Greg and Edgar drove up from West Virginia, undaunted by the fact that the official rally was postponed until next Wednesday, March the 22nd. But we're going to move it up to Monday for reasons that I will explain. Wednesday is no longer on. It will be Monday. Permits are already in hand. The rally will take place inside the Capitol Building Rotunda in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, on Monday. All these people decided to take in the sights after dropping off some of their letters to state representatives' offices, chosen at random. There undoubtedly have been others who did their share who were not seen. They were there to heed the call, their armament being written with the mighty pen of truth. Most of the legislative offices were absent. Their legislators who were in their home districts, many would not be entirely safe from the wrath of those who know and value their freedoms guaranteed under the Constitution. And these agents of change will soon learn that we are indeed the principals, as the truth is spread throughout Pennsylvania and indeed from state to state. Over 200 years ago, the Reverend Muhlenberg preached from the steps of the old church in Harrisburg, denounced King George, and carried the cry for liberty. General George Washington met with the newly appointed colonial officers in Philadelphia. He told them, "Go forth and raise you each regiments of foot for the times to come." One such colonial captain did so in the Pennsylvania communities of Concordville, Chadsford, Marcus Hook, and Booth's Corners. His task was to face the British at Brandywine Creek. Pennsylvanians rose to the occasion and defeated the British threat. What was thought to be only a minor skirmish had a much greater significance in that the British greatly underestimated the outnumbered, outsupplied, outgunned ordinaries. So, too, must you raise regiments of foot first to descend upon the Pennsylvania state capital and perhaps the greater battle yet to come in Philadelphia. Battles are to be fought in your own state houses also. Let the cry of liberty ring clearly throughout the land, and let God's people be free again. This from our station chief in Pennsylvania. Now you know why he is our station chief. Again, it was learned, and this is very good news, from an informed source in the Pennsylvania state capitol this day, that the resolution authorizing Pennsylvania's participation at the Conference of States has been put on political hold. House leaders decided yesterday to send the measure back to the House Committee on Intergovernmental Affairs, and it will remain in committee until planners of the Conference of States, Leavitt et al., determine whether any legislative authority by the individual states is needed at all. It appears, ladies and gentlemen, that the strong opposition and planned demonstration by the Constitution Party and many other groups uniting behind the Constitution Party against this measure has forced these planners to rethink another way around the Constitution. In another flash, the Philadelphia City Council voted unanimously to request the Pennsylvania legislature not to participate in the Conference of States. This is a wonderful defeat for the New World Order, a wonderful victory for us. We must not do anything to humiliate these people. They have come around the right way of thinking, but it's not over yet. We must keep up the momentum until victory is at hand. Your planners at the Constitution Party, Aaron Russo, chairman, William Cooper, me, the president, Karen Scarborough, the national director, the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, the Intelligence Service, along with some strong allies in the state capitol, have determined that the best time for a rally in the battle for Pennsylvania would be on Monday, March 20th at 11:30 a.m. With help from our friends on the inside, we have been able to get a permit for this rally inside the main capitol building in the rotunda. This is wonderful. We have tentatively scheduled speakers in the caliber, well, we'll let you be surprised. Several of the Pennsylvania state legislators and others. A mixed bag of Americans who have answered the call, a group of ordinaries who have the opportunity to turn the tide of battle. Sadly, most Americans have no comprehension of the constitutional role of their government, nor do they comprehend the responsibilities regarding them. They don't even know that anything is happening because it's not printed in their newspapers. It's not on the NBC, CBS, or ABC News. It's not on CNN. Some very, very powerful people don't want anyone to know what's happening in the legislatures across the United States. Most people comprehend not the precipice, the brink of disaster whereon they stand. These resolutions of participation are being rushed through the state houses of all of the states throughout the Union. We must do everything in our power to stop this blatant attempt to destroy the Constitution of the United States of America. If we win in Pennsylvania on Monday, that will be a great, great victory for the side of those who love liberty. Now, this just isn't happening in Pennsylvania, ladies and gentlemen. It's happening all over the United States. All over. Before anyone even knew what was happening, it was in and out of some of the legislatures of some of the states without the people who even lived in those states even knowing what happened. Now, this coming Wednesday in the state of California, they will vote on the participation resolution for the Conference of States for the state of California. It is imperative that everyone in the state of California and anyone who is able from the nearby states to travel to the state capitol and protest this. It is also important that you fax or telephone the senators who will be voting on SCR 9 in committee in California this week. I'm going to give you their names, their telephone numbers, and their fax numbers, and their office numbers. And I'm going to tell you their address, how to write to them. Everybody, get a pen, get a piece of paper, and be prepared to write. And just like you've done for the last 2 days, last 3 days, call, fax, telegram, write, and don't stop until this resolution is killed in the state of California. And don't forget Philadelphia. Philadelphia is a key event. Philadelphia must be stopped. California must be stopped. They all must be stopped. But the advantage, the psychological advantage, will be the heaviest if we can defeat this in Pennsylvania. So, ladies and gentlemen, everybody rush out, get pen and paper or pencil, and remember, don't ever, ever listen to the hour of the time without a tablet and a pen or pencil by your side. Okay, folks, get ready to write, because here it comes. Dave Kelly. Telephone 916-445-2802. That's Dave Kelly, 916-445-2802. His fax is 916-327-2187. That's 916-327-2187. His office number is 3082. That's 3082. Patrick Johnson. Telephone 916-445-2802. That's 916. Oh, I gave you the wrong number, folks. Patrick Johnson is 916-445-2407. That's 916-445-2407. His fax is 916-327-4213. Again, the fax is 916-327-4213, and his office number is 5066. Make sure you write these down. 5066. Ken Maddy, M-A-D-D-Y. His telephone is 916-445-9600. That's 916-445-9600. His fax number is 916-327-3523. That's 916-327-3523. His office number is 305. Now, that's the number on the door, if you know what I'm talking about. Nicholas Petrus. His telephone number is 916-445-6577. 916-445-6577. His fax number is 916-327-1997. That's 916-327-1997. And his office number is 5080. The next one is Alfred Alquist, A-L-Q-U-I-S-T, Alfred Alquist. His telephone is 916-445-9740. That's 916-445-9740. Fax number. This is the fax number, 916-323-8386. That's 916-323-8386. And his office number is 5100. Now, if you'd like to write a letter to these people, I hope you all phone, fax, write, and telegram. For those of you writing or sending telegrams, put down the senator's name, his office number. All of these are California state senators. Put down the senator's name, his office number, state capital, Sacramento, California, 95814. That's the senator's name, office number, state capital, Sacramento, California, 95814. I'm going to go through these one more time, just in case you didn't get them. Dave Kelly, telephone 916-445-2802. Fax 916-327-2187. His office number is 3082. Patrick Johnson, 916-445-2407. Fax is 916-327-4213. His office number is 5066. Ken Maddy, spelled M-A-D-D-Y, telephone 916-445-9600. Fax is 916-327-3523. Office number 305. Nicholas Petris, P-E-T-R-I-S, telephone 916-445-6577. The fax is 916-327-1997. His office number is 5080. And the last, Alfred Alquist, spelled A-L-Q-U-I-S-T. Telephone 916-445-9740. Fax is 916-323-8386. And his office number is 5100. To write, just put down the senator's name, his office number, state capital, Sacramento, California, 95814. And that's for California. Those five senators, California state senators, will be voting in committee whether to bring the California resolution, participation resolution for the Conference of the States to vote in the California state legislature. If they vote no, it will die right there in that committee. So start your work now. Everybody who can be there must be there on Monday in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania at 11:30 a.m. in the rotunda of the Capitol building. There will be speakers, some quite prominent speakers. Some Pennsylvania state legislators will be speaking against this. We must make a show of force. And I'll tell you why, ladies and gentlemen. Because they plan to convene on Monday, and because of all the things that have been going on, they want to adjourn again on Tuesday. So this is why we changed it from Wednesday to Monday. Remember, it was going to be today, as a matter of fact, and they adjourned rather than face you. So we're making headway. We're making ourselves heard. We are making it count. America doesn't want this. They thought that they were going to sneak this through all the state legislatures across the country. not have it appear on any of the news channels, none of the news broadcasts, none of the newspapers, nothing. They thought they were going to get away with it. But thanks to people who are out there acting as the watchdogs, most abdicate, we found out about it. Oh, and I heard Tom Valentine's going to talk about this tomorrow night. Sorry, Tom, you're a day late and a dollar short. You see, you should have been up here on the front lines with everybody. This stuff could have snuck through. Now, there's some other important things that are going on that you're going to have to know about. And we'll get to those in just a couple of minutes. And then we're going to open the phones and hear what you've got to say out there. And I want to hear from people who have called and talked to some of these legislators. And I also want to warn you, you had better get your nose in your state house and find out if it's in your state legislature. And if it is, you better get on the talk shows. You better notify me. You better notify everybody that you can. And you've got to stop it in your state also. You know, it may have already gone through your state legislature, in which case you need to put pressure on your legislators to introduce another resolution to recall it. This is no joke. This, ladies and gentlemen, is deadly serious. And if we fail in our responsibility, we could lose all of the protection of our liberties, all of the limitations on government. As they convene the Conference of States and flush the Constitution right down the toilet. Yes, where would you be without the hour of the time? And if it were not for the sponsorship of Swiss America Trading, you would not be listening to the hour of the time. We would not have scored the victories that we have scored in the last couple of days, and we might be staring disaster right in the face. Swiss America Trading, Craig Smith, all of the good people down there who have supported and backed the hour of the time, who have given you all good service, who have enabled you, no matter how much money you have or what you can afford or how many payments you can make, to put your hands on some real money so that you'll be prepared in the chaos that's sure to come. And, of course, if you derive real worth from this broadcast, you should call them just to say thank you for bringing you the hour of the time. In fact, why don't you do that? Call Swiss America Trading and say thank you for bringing you this broadcast. The only place, ladies and gentlemen, where you can really find out what's happening, cut through all the crap, all the rumors, all the bullshit, and get right down to the nitty-gritty, where we're out here fighting on the front lines of the battle for liberty. Call them and thank them. And while you're at it, ask someone to call you back or ask if you can talk to someone about how you can get your hands on some real money and help protect your family, your loved ones, in the days, weeks, months, and possibly years ahead. Do it now. 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Look around you. Look in the eyes of your loved ones. If you cannot assure them right now that you've taken steps to ensure that at least a part of your assets are protected in the form of real money, gold or silver coin, then you must make this call.
You must, or else you're lying about how much you love them. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. A great weight will come off your shoulders. You'll be glad that you did. They guarantee what they do. They offer a buyback plan, and I guarantee what they do. And if they don't do it, you call me. I'll make sure that whatever is right is done. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now. Listen to this. This is the Omnibus Counterterrorism Bill, S-390 and H.R. 896. Looks like 896. That's Senate Bill 390 and House Resolution 896. It is a new FBI charter to investigate political groups. This is urgent. Write these down. In the Senate, S-390, and in the House, House Resolution, or H.R. 896. On February the 10th, 1995, the Omnibus Counterterrorism Bill was introduced as S-390 into the Senate and as H.R. 896 in the House. These people are rabid. They are mentally ill. When you hear this, you will be infuriated. I'm angry. Angry. It was initiated by the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the same people who helped murder all of those women and children and innocent men in Waco, Texas. And it was passed on by the Justice Department and the White House, where all those socialists abide. Senators Biden, Democrat, Delaware, and Specter, Republican, Pennsylvania, initiated it in the Senate. Representative Schumer, Democrat, New York, and Dix, Democrat, Washington, in the House. It has bipartisan support. I don't know where this support comes from. No American could ever support anything like this, but it does have bipartisan support and could get expedited action. I'm going to give you a summary of what's contained in this, in these two pieces of legislation. It is a general charter for the Federal Bureau of Investigation and other agencies, including the military, to investigate political groups and causes at will. So if you belong to any political group or any cause, no matter how harmless, these people can initiate investigations on you at will, with no probable cause, no reason whatsoever. The bill is a wide-ranging federalization of different kinds of actions applying to both citizens and non-citizens. In fact, the range includes acts of violence, attempts, threats, and conspiracies, as well as giving funds, if you just give a dollar, for humanitarian legal activity. Legal activity. Specifically says legal activity. It would allow up to a 10-year sentence for citizens and deportation for permanent resident non-citizens for the, quote, crime, end quote, of supporting the lawful activities of an organization the president declares to be terrorist. In other words, it's up to the president. He can say anybody he wants is a terrorist, or any group or organization is a terrorist. the crime of supporting the lawful activities of an organization the president declares to be terrorist. In other words, if the president says that your organization or activity is terrorist, any lawful activity that you engage in with that organization or activity is a crime. And the bills, both of them, say lawful activities, legal. And it names such as the African National Congress, FMLN in El Salvador, the IRA in Northern Ireland, and the PLO. All have been labeled. But you see, the IRA is setting up offices here in the United States with the blessings of the United States government. It's not about the IRA. It's not about the African National Congress. This gives the president the ability to name whoever he wants. Political enemies. He could name the Republican Party if he wants to, because there are no guidelines in this. This is the most un-American, most terrible thing that I've seen come down the pike in a long time. This sounds exactly like what everybody has been in utter fear of since before this country was even dreamed of. The president's determination of who is a terrorist is unappealable. You can't even appeal it. And specifically can include groups regardless of any legitimate activity they might pursue. It authorizes secret trials for immigrants who are not charged with a crime, but rather who are accused of supporting lawful activity by organizations which have also been accused of committing illegal acts, but not tried or found guilty. Immigrants could be deported, using evidence they or their lawyers would never see in this secret trial. In secret proceedings with one-sided appeals using illegally obtained evidence. Can you believe this? Can you believe this, ladies and gentlemen? It suspends posse comitatus. It suspends posse comitatus, allowing the use of the military to engage in law enforcement activities regardless of any other laws. In other words, it legalizes the Waco massacre and any future Waco massacres that might occur. It reverses the presumption of innocence. The accused is presumed ineligible for bail and can be detained until trial with no appeal. It loosens the rules for wiretaps. It would prohibit probation as a punishment under the Act, even for minor nonviolent offenses. And what is the offense? Engaging in legal and lawful activities with an organization that the president has named as a terrorist organization, such as the militia. The implications, ladies and gentlemen, for those who remember the McCarran-Walter Act will recognize this bill. Only in some ways this is broader and potentially much more dangerous than the McCarran-Walter Act ever could be. This bill is political. It is a political arrow aimed at any opposition that the president wants to get rid of. The president can determine who is a terrorist and change his or her mind at will, and even for economic reasons. The breadth of its coverage would make it impossible for the government to prosecute all assistance to groups around the world that have made or threatened to commit violent acts of any sort. Necessarily, its choices would be targeted at organizations the government found currently offensive. People to be deported would be chosen specifically because of their political associations and beliefs. The new federal crime, international terrorism, doesn't cover anything that is not already a crime. As the Center for National Security Studies notes, and I quote, "Since the new offense does not cover anything that is not already a crime, the main purpose of the proposal seems to be to avoid certain constitutional and statutory protections that would otherwise apply," end quote. While many provisions of this bill, ladies and gentlemen, could well be found unconstitutional after years and years of litigation, in the meantime, the damage could be devastating to any group that supports the Constitution or could be called patriotic militia. The Hour of the Time, the Intelligence Service, the Citizens Agency for Joint Intelligence, the Republican Party, the Democratic Party, the Constitution Party, anybody that the President wishes to name. The First Amendment and other constitutional protections, including presumption of innocence and right to bail. These two bills have been referred to judiciary committees of each house. Only the New York Times has yet noticed this bill. In a February 24, 1995, Anthony Lewis column. And this is a column. A column comes from outside the paper. So as such, you can't even credit the New York Times. Anthony Lewis put it in his column. All the media throughout the country should be alerted, but don't feel slighted if they don't carry it. They don't carry anything that's important. No. Nope. If it doesn't have to do with the OJ trial, it ain't gonna be covered. And if you're watching the OJ trial, you need to go stand in the corner. For more information on this, ladies and gentlemen, call Kit Gage. Kit Gage. K-I-T. Last name, Gage. G-A-G-E. The Washington liaison of the National Lawyers Guild. He's the Washington liaison for the National Lawyers Guild. As much as I despise lawyers organizations, in this case, they're doing a good job. 3321 12th Street. That's 3321 12th Street, Northeast, Washington, D.C., 20017. That's 3321 12th Street, Northeast, Washington, D.C., 20017. The telephone number is 202-529-4225. That's 202-529-4225. The fax is 202-526-4611. That's 202-526-4611. And remember who these were introduced by: Senators Biden and Specter. And in the House, Representative Schumer and Dix. If you ever thought that they were on our side, you better think again. Okay, we're going to go to the phones, folks. And I have somebody holding on here for a long time. I want to apologize to them for keeping them on for so long. But they called before I said the phones were open, so they really can't complain. Good evening. You're on the air.
You know, you're correct. I can't complain, and I thank you for your patience.
Okay, what can I do for you?
This is Howard calling you from Philadelphia. You and I spoke last week at some length.
Mm-hmm.
I was recruited by your Pennsylvania station chief.
Wonderful.
At our Villanova meeting last month. He asked me to tell you that he has received some unwelcome attention, so not to use his name on the air.
Well, if you've been listening, you've never heard me use his name on the air.
No, no, he asked me not to use his name on the air.
Oh, okay. I thought you were asking me not to.
No, not at all. I've been listening to your messages and listening to what you said, and part of what you brought up was on my internet list, NoConCon, and I wonder if you might allow me to tell people how to get on that, because I got a message from Aaron Russo, apparently he's on there now, about the Philadelphia City Council even before I knew about it. Evidently, the local papers here won't even report it.
No, they won't report it anywhere across the country.
Yeah, and one of the people on my list made the suggestion that people should start calling some of the columnists, like Walter Williams and some of the other ones that write about constitutional issues, and ask them why they're not talking about it. I've been trying to get on C-SPAN and some of the other ones on the telephone lines.
Oh, they should be doing more than that. They should be down there at their local newspapers in masse. I mean, there should be hundreds of people beating on their desk.
Oh, no, you'll get no argument from me on that, but it's quite easy to get on C-SPAN early in the morning when they have that journalist roundtable or something like that and ask the journalists why they're not reporting on this, and I would be...
Oh, I should rub it in their face.
They don't even know what it is.
If three football players get together to have tea, it makes the headlines.
No, and you're quite correct. You know, most of America is focusing on the wrong things, although... some of my customers, being more of the liberal persuasion, have taken quite an interest when you tell them that the Constitution is being attacked, and they see it as their last fortress.
You know why? Let me tell you something. I did an experiment the other day. A reporter from one of the local newspapers came in and apologized to me for running a story based upon what had been run in the Arizona Republic, trying to demonize me and the Arizona militia. And while we were talking, she asked me if I was a conservative, and I said, well, there's no such thing. And she said, well, are you a liberal? I said, there's no such thing. We're either Americans or we're not. She scratched her head and said, well, I really don't understand. And I says, well, what do you consider yourself to be? She said, well, I'm a conservative. And I said, what does that mean? She says, well, in my estimation, a conservative is someone who's looking for the truth and wants to do the right thing and is trying to be active and make it a better world. And, you know, I stopped her right then and I said, do you understand that what you just said is exactly the same words that a liberal would describe themselves with? Exactly. And as an illustration, I then asked a liberal what they thought the definition of liberal was, and you would not believe they said exactly the same thing that she had said.
Well, I think when you come right down to basics, we all believe the same thing. It's a matter of whether or not people will do anything. In that vein, is it all right with you if I tell people how to subscribe to this on the Internet?
Yeah, do it real quick, though.
Okay. Send email to me, PCMan. That's PC-MAN, PC-MAN, the at symbol, at netaccess.com. That's spelled NETAXS.com. Let me repeat that once again. Just send me email saying you want to subscribe to NoCopCon to PC-MAN, the at symbol, which is above the 2 on the keyboard, at the at symbol at netaccess, N-E-T, AXS.com, and I'll put you on the list. I'm getting like 30 or 40 new people a day, and the information, I think I've got somebody in just about every state, and I wrote down all the information that you gave about California, and I'll be putting that out as soon as I hang up the phone.
Good.
And the good thing about that is that that information goes out to right now. I think there's about 400 people on there, and if we can, all of those 400 people can get a couple of other people to write letters and make phone calls, then it can start mushrooming.
It better mushroom.
Well, I think we saw some of the effects of that mushroom here in Pennsylvania, because for my beliefs, I wouldn't have even thought the city council would have even acknowledged.
No, they wouldn't have. We put so much pressure on people in Pennsylvania that it's amazing. And adjourning the legislature was unprecedented, just simply because of the pressure that had been put on for a piece of legislation.
Well, and I think now what people in Pennsylvania have to understand in other states, we cannot let up, not even one inch. We've got to put even more pressure on until this is absolutely gone.
Yeah.
And then we got to move on to the other states where it's still alive.
Yeah, people are beginning to find out that what I've been telling them is true. We've never had an enemy outside the United States that could ever hurt us. All the enemies that we have that can hurt us are in this country, and they are dead set on destroying the United States and creating one world government.
Well, if I could offer one more suggestion before I hang up.
Make it quick.
What I have found from many of my customers who I said are of the liberal persuasion is that the last thing that they would want to see is a Republican-dominated conference happening anywhere, because they're obviously wary of what's going on in Washington right now. And when you mention something to them, well, how would you feel about, you know, a conference where most of the governors are Republican, and those governors get to pick who those legislators are that go with them.
Well, I think that's the wrong tack. I think that people better understand that they're Americans. They better stop thinking Republican and Democrat and liberal and conservative and black and Oriental and white and Indian and all of this crap that divides us. We're either Americans or we're not. We either believe in America or we don't. We either understand what made this country great and gave us what we have or we don't. And if we don't, we're finished. That's all there is to it.
And I agree with you, Bill, but you have to realize that some people...
No, I don't. I have to
change... ...their ideology that they cannot...
No, I have to change the way that people think. We have to go back to America and Americans. There's only one ideology in this country. That's the country that made America. That's the country that built America. That's the country that gave us all the opportunity and all of the good things that we have today, and no other nation in this entire world has ever even begun to come close. So all of those kinds of arguments don't wash with me. I don't listen to them. I don't give them any credence, nothing. We're Americans, and America is going to survive, or we're not Americans, and Americans and America is not going to survive. And that's where we're at right now. This is about survival. And there's only one way that this country will survive, and that's if everybody screws their head on straight. Good evening. You're on the air.
Oh, my. You're angry, and I'm in kind of shock after that last little bill you read.
Boy, I certainly am angry. I am very angry.
It'll take me tomorrow to get angry. That's the implications of that is pretty deep. By the way, that liberal conservative thing that you mentioned, the best answer I ever heard was out of Walter Williams. He said he was a classical liberal. That left everybody confused.
Well, I'm an American.
There you go. Okay, anyhow, in the state of Maryland, it's HJR 13. It was voted down in committee. It's now HJR 10. It's in committee.
So they just voted it down and switched the number and put it right back in, right?
Right back in again.
Okay, so that's Maryland. Fax that information to me and we'll be on Maryland's case.
Dig a little deeper. Thank you much.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
Good night. 602-337-2524 is the number for all of those who have never written it down or never called before. Good evening. You're on the air.
That's right, Mr. Cooper. Today here, I'm calling from South Carolina, by the way, but as you show, today in Charlotte, Mr. Aaron Russo was on the local AM affiliate. They have a three-hour show, an extremely liberal host. Mr. Russo took the first hour and did a great job representing the Constitution Party. Was actually very well received by the host. I was amazed. I was able to get through. I was the first caller through today, and I asked Mr. Russo, I said, I told him I was familiar with him and the party, had heard a lot about it on the Bill Cooper Show on shortwave. I encourage people to get a shortwave and try to find your show and other shows of this type to stay abreast of this type of stuff. I asked Mr. Russo, I said, sir, according to Mr. Cooper on his show last night, our country is running headlong into a constitutional convention next week in Philadelphia. What's your reaction to that, and where does the Constitution Party stand on that? Mr. Russo gave a great monologue that I wish you could hear. I wish I had it on tape. He gave a great monologue, very much like the one that you gave last night on this issue. And from that point forward, the next 2 hours of the show were dominated as Mr. Russo and the host bantered about this constitutional convention. The host was flabbergasted. He knew nothing of this. He was very intrigued. They took up an extra hour on his show, and people were faxing in information on this con. And I'm going to do another hour on it tomorrow, I'm proud to say.
Wonderful. By the way, I'll be with Mr. Russo all weekend as the leaders of the Constitution Party go into sort of an emergency crisis conference. And I'll be back here on Monday night with the rhetoric blazing. Thank you for calling.
Thank you, sir.
602-337-2524 is the number. That's 602-337-2524. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hey, Bill. Today in California, I called around to several of my assemblymen, and they were aware of it. They've had a lot of heat out here about the convention. But I called Senator John Lewis's office. He's not on this committee that's going to be ruling on this thing, is he?
No. The names that I gave you are the five that are on the committee that will make the decision on whether it goes in front of the legislature for a vote. Senator Don Rogers is in communication with us, and he is leading the opposition. and he has convinced two of those five to vote against it. We must get one more on our side.
Okay, well, we'll do that. But Senator Lewis's office, the person who received my phone call, didn't think that this was too big a deal, but they've had a lot of phone calls about it, and he said it would, I don't know, it was big out of ignorance, but he said it'll probably be a long time before it comes up for a vote. Now, you told us it'll be Wednesday, so.
Yeah, you have to understand that a lot of legislators are just sheeple with legislator hung around their neck. And they don't think it's any big deal because they don't know any more about the Constitution than most of those other sheeple out there watching OJ every day. In fact, if they don't have to be in the legislature, they're probably watching OJ too.
Yeah.
Which, by the way,
that's all you get on the news. In fact, it goes on 24 hours a day practically, except when they go to bed. I got your Constitution Party thing there with the lawsuit thing, and I've been passing that around. We're going to do some real work on that one.
Good.
And that's a real coup, I think. That thing is really great. So
yes, it is.
Keep up the good work, and we're backing you up.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for calling.
Good night.
Well, folks, that's it. The last few days, I've got to tell you, all of those of you who have been helping, we have been effective. Don't ever let me hear you say that one person can't do anything. Look what I did, and look what you did, and look what those people in Pennsylvania have done. Look what Senator Charles Duke has done. Look what Don Rogers in California has done. Look what Gwen Wyckoff has done with Perspectives, with Perceptions magazine. So, we're all just one person. We're no different than any of you. And for those of you who have been sitting on your couch, waiting for all of us to save you and doing nothing, hey, you better change that attitude, because there's going to come a day when you're going to come to us crying, and we're going to say very simply, screw you. You had your chance. Good night, folks, and God bless you all.
Thank you.